President of the Forum for National Unity, Mr. N.M. Amin, members of the respected ulama who are here, our Islamic theologians, the chief guest of the special felicitation ceremony, Honorable Ruan Vijayawardena, Member of Parliament, State Minister of Defense, Defense Secretary Mr. Karuna Sena Hettiarachchi, the President of the All Ceylon Jamiatul Ulama, Maulavi Riz Mufti, respected friends, members of the civil society, and distinguished Muslims who are present here today. Let me thank Mr. Amin, President of the Forum, for inviting me to speak on this occasion of felicitating Honorable Ruan Vijayawardena MP, State Minister of Defense. Let us all wish the chief guest a great and successful role in rebuilding our country. The gathering here tonight is a very distinguished assembly of Muslims. The presence of such a large and representative gathering at this event to felicitate our chief guest is a clear message that as patriotic citizens of Sri Lanka, the support of the Muslims in the endeavors of the State Minister of Defense and his officials to build a peaceful and united Sri Lanka will be readily available. It would be unduly presumptuous on my part to assume that the authorities may be unaware of the matters that would be referred to tonight, as they regularly update themselves. But our objective tonight is twofold. Firstly, to revisit some of the concerns of the Muslims and place them within the perspective of the country's national interest. Secondly, the time has come to alert our own community on the need to exercise vigilance. Intelligence gathering is important, but gathering reliable and accurate information is more important. Avoiding misleading or dubious information placed by parties with vested interests is absolutely important. A wrong judgment in interpreting intelligence can cost lives. Indeed, it has cost lives. Let me refer to one of several such instances. You know quite well that less than a month ago, the report of the four-member committee of Privy Council members appointed by the British government to hold a public inquiry into Britain's role in the invasion of Iraq in 2003 was released. Headed by Sir John Chilcot, the committee blamed, among others, the British Secret Intelligence Service, better known as M16, for presenting to the then British government the so-called hot intelligence, as described in the report, of Iraq possessing weapons of mass destruction. The war on Iraq was launched, and you know the consequences. Over 1.5 million innocent human lives were destroyed in Iraq, apart from several other devastating consequences to Iraq and to humanity. The point that we need to remember is that the Chilcot report exposes the dangers of subverting unreliable intelligence to achieve collateral objectives. The M16 report played a crucial role in obliging those who had already decided to invade Iraq. The President of the National Unity, of the Forum for National Unity, Alhaj Amin, said very emphatically a while ago, that was also followed by our distinguished Maulavi Sheikh Rizvi Mufti, who underscored that the Muslims have nothing to do with any terror outfit whatsoever, whether ISIS or any other. That is a statement, sir, that will have the unanimous approval of the entire Muslim community of this country. Nevertheless, we are equally clear that every bit of terror information must be investigated thoroughly and dealt with firmly in a transparent manner and according to law. Zero tolerance is the name. Though there are legal limitations in the armed forces handling surveillance measures and investigations, the police under the Ministry of Law and Order can step in and assist the process. Recently, there were reports published in sections of the media alleging that two Keralites from South India had transited through Nigambu to join the ISIS. The banner headline of this daily screamed, "Colombo Hub for Islamic Fundamentalism." When you analyze the text of this report, you will not find any material to support the mischievous headline that Colombo had become the hub for Islamic fundamentalism, or the allegation that the Kerala couple, a man and a woman, had anything to do with the ISIS or even had joined the ISIS. Even the names of the two persons are not recognizable Muslim names. The published text quotes the origin of this story to an Indian intelligence source, but whose name or the name of the institutions which the source represented was not even disclosed. Interestingly, that same daily wrote a very welcome editorial last Tuesday, 2nd of August. Good for every one of us to read that. Referring to the story of the Kerala couple, the editorial said, I quote, "Sadly, this has been nothing but a media spectacle made out of a bogus story. This trend of exaggerated yellow journalism with regard to terrorism has gone a long distance and should not be allowed to continue. These reports of ill-sourced, ill-informed, and downright horrendous journalism should stop altogether," unquote. A very welcome editorial indeed, coming as it does from the editor of this daily, which had carried the Kerala story earlier. In addition to the editor of this daily, there is someone in this gathering, present among us tonight, whom we should compliment for this refreshing editorial. He has been named in the editorial itself. The daily is quoting this gentleman as having stated that the media is going to town with unnecessary attention on things that never happened. Indeed, he had the authority to say what he said. He is none other than our Defense Secretary, Mr. Karunara Sena Hettiarach. He deserves your appreciation. I think a round of applause. And a round of applause to the Honorable Minister, who is having such a capable team to handle matters in the best interest of the country. Please, thank you. Having looked into a few media reports published previously, I wish to underline the point that reports of this nature, without any credibility, are being planted in the media from time to time by entities with an agenda of their own, even though our defense establishment had rejected such reports. Comprehensive investigation, including interviewing those who initiate these allegations in whichever part of the world they may be from, will be extremely valuable. Among such reports is one in which it was claimed that the Lashkar-e-Taiba, also known as LET, had established a facilitation center in Sri Lanka. That was in 2009, exactly 1 month after the war ended. It is 7 years since the war ended. We are yet to find such a center. It is similar to the WMD story. 4 years later, in 2013, one Madhav Nalapath filed a Colombo Dateline story in the Indian weekly Sunday Guardian that Sri Lanka is fast becoming the center, becoming the new launching pad for Pakistan's alleged terror outfit, Lashkar-e-Taiba. It is 3 years since the Nalapath story got published, and it is now known that there is no truth in the story. Colombo-based Nalapath should have been questioned by the Sri Lankan authorities and his assistance sought to cross-check his claims, however ridiculous they may have been. In 2013, another story allegedly leaked to the media by an unnamed foreign intelligence source said that led terrorists had planned to carry out an attack on South India from Jaffna. These were all blatant lies that got published in the media, but stories that people thought were true and injected false fears in the hearts and minds of the people here of possible terror attacks in Sri Lanka. That is terrible news for a country which had just come out of 30 years of war and suffering. These and similar unfounded allegations of possible terror attacks by persons with Muslim identity have made the innocent Muslims here a suspect community. That is a very painful reflection on a community that stood against terrorism in this country. As has already been mentioned by previous speakers, our community suffered tremendously due to its uncompromising stand against LTTE terrorism. Those Tamil-speaking Muslims evicted by the LTTE from the north are still to be resettled in their original lands. The Defense Ministry is fully aware of the many Muslims who sacrificed their precious lives while serving in the armed forces. I'm not going to go into details. Some names have already been mentioned in this regard. I would only like to refer to what the Bangladesh Home Minister told the BBC recently, that there is evidence of Israeli agents being behind the killings of innocent Hindu priests in West Bengal. It is well known that Zionists, the neocons, and the arms industry have agents. The only point that I wish to urge is that we need to alert our border control for possible external deadly agents of terror if we are to avoid possible mayhem within our country. Vigilance, irrespective of nationalities, ethnicities, and faith, must be enhanced. The cooperation of all sections of our people must be sought. I'm not saying, nor am I knowledgeable enough to say, that something is about to happen here. All I am saying is, it had happened in our region and can happen here. The compass for detection must be universal and not merely ethnic or religious oriented. We, the Muslims of Sri Lanka, must cooperate with the authorities by playing a more proactive role. The mechanism that needs to be established for such a role is a matter that the community should go into first and discuss with the authorities thereafter. I wish to refer to India's 2008 Ahmedabad bombings, in which bombs had been planted in 21 locations in Ahmedabad, in Gujarat, India. Several local TV channels said that they had received an email from a terror outfit called the Indian Mujahideen, claiming responsibility for the blast. What is relevant to us tonight is an Associated Press, also known as AP, report that was filed on the 29th of July 2008, according to which the email in which the Indian Mujahideen had claimed responsibility for the explosions, which were to occur shortly, the message went out shortly before the Ahmedabad blast took place, which were to occur shortly, had been sent from the computer of an American national named Ken Haywood, operating from Bombay. As far as I know, there was total silence thereafter on Ken Haywood's role in dispatching the advanced terror threat. His email predicting terror in Ahmedabad that night turned out to be frighteningly true, with 56 dead and over 200 injured. We are left wondering who is speaking for whom and whether the US guy is the global voice for the Indian Mujahideen. A very important case from the intelligence point of view, but appears to have been mishandled. We have seen similar claims purportedly from Al-Qaeda, the ISIS, and other globally branded terror outfits appearing in the media from time to time, claiming responsibility for almost every act of terror occurring in all corners of the globe. Coincidentally, we also hear reports predicting terror attacks, mostly quoting unnamed intelligence sources, as if some of them are acting hand in glove with terror outfits. Only in intensive investigations by our authorities, wherever Sri Lanka is allegedly linked, can reveal the true face of terrorism. Our intelligence personnel and investigators must be facilitated to travel to any part of the world to join the local investigators of cases in which Sri Lanka is allegedly linked. Let me, before I wrap up, refer to one such recent incident which Sri Lanka failed to investigate. In December last year, a 40-year-old Israeli arrived at the Bandar Naik International Airport on a fake Iranian passport. Why an Israeli on a fake Iranian passport? That would be the relevant question anyone will raise. He also had an Israeli passport with his correct picture, but with a different name, kept concealed in his baggage. Why did he come prepared to masquerade as an Iranian while in Sri Lanka, unless he had some dangerous mission? A dangerous mission here, and perhaps to leave on a different identity. He had arrived from Mumbai and was detected by the immigration at Katunayake while attempting to enter Sri Lanka on the forged Iranian passport. The man had committed, as far as the law of Sri Lanka is concerned, several offenses falling under several limbs of Section 45 of the Immigration and Emigration Act. He should have been produced before a magistrate, as the immigration officials normally do in such cases. We have also a member of the judiciary here. I'm sure he will also agree that that is the correct position of our law. The guy should have been questioned by the intelligence authorities and the CID unit of the police, which works on a 24-hour, 365 operation at the airport. The offences carry a minimum sentence of 1 year to 5 years in prison and to fines in addition. They ought to have elicited valuable information. The man was allowed to go back to Mumbai in the very next flight without being dealt with for violating our laws. The troubling question that I wish to raise is, assuming the Israeli man had been cleared on arrival, and if he had either himself or contracted for dollars a narcotic addict to leave some explosive package near some temples here and left the Iranian passport close to the site of the planned explosions, similar to the 21 bombs planted by someone in Ahmedabad, and similar to the explosives planted in 2013 at the world-renowned Mahabodhi Temple in Buddha Gaya in Bihar, North India. Would that not be the beginning of anti-Muslim riots here? It is a serious possibility. It has happened elsewhere. It can happen here. It is not such a difficult task to those with access to dollars and to explosives. That is why we respectfully urge the authorities and all the citizens in our country, particularly the Muslims, to be vigilant. Incidentally, the Explosive Act also comes under the purview of the Defense Ministry. We need to be alert to all possibilities. We cannot afford to go home and forget our obligations by our country, by our people, and by our families. I've taken a lot of your valuable time, but do allow me to summarize the more essential points. Firstly, the armed forces and the police, to the extent the law permits, should comprehensively investigate all reports relating to allegations of terrorism, including those published in the media, quoting unidentified sources. Secondly, intelligence gathering must encompass not only possible ISIS or other terror infiltration, but also cover foreign agents who may venture into the country for operations similar to the David Headley's of Bombay Taj Hotel massacre fame, and Ken Haywood, to whom I made reference. Thirdly, identify dubious intelligence reports planted by vested interests, possibly the agents of the arms industry. Fourthly, enhance the need for the country in general and the Muslims in particular, to be vigilant for terror-related activities without needlessly exciting fears. Fifthly, Muslims do to explore possible areas of cooperation with the authorities to strengthen terror-related intelligence gathering and investigations. We thank the Chief Guest, Honorable Ruan Vijayawardena, State Minister of Defense, and all of you for your patient hearing, and the Forum for National Unity, Mr. Amin and his team, for organizing this event. Let me conclude by adding that the views expressed are my own and do not reflect or represent the office that I hold. Thank you very much.
Media Network.